Many of the world's most exclusive trains offer discerning travellers a revival of the romantic age of railway travel. This, one of the very few world-class trains, represents the very apotheosis of railborne luxury, combining the splendour of Edwardian style with modern-day comforts. The Royal Scotsman took us and our fellow passengers on a four-night journey through a country overflowing with history and heritage. This is no ordinary train ride, more a stylish and sedate adventure aboard an elegant haven, through a magnificent and remote landscape shaped by an eternity of evolution. Taking in on the way some of Scotland's finest sights, along with indigenous Highland wildlife and some of the world's most beautiful scenery. Aboard the Royal Scotsman, you can experience an unrivaled encounter with centuries of tradition and heritage, and see Scotland at its very finest. Our journey began in the capital city of Scotland, Edinburgh. The city's modern railway station sits beneath the walls of Edinburgh's ancient castle. And it was here, at Waverley Station, that we awaited the arrival of our train. Punctual to the minute, the Royal Scotsman arrived. Gliding smoothly in, the gleaming locomotive and nine vintage carriages, resplendent in their imperial purple livery, slowly pulled to a halt at the platform. As it sat graciously at the platform's edge, it was obvious that this was a true aristocrat of the world of trains and a magnificent ambassador for railway travel, worthy of its regal title. The staff of the Royal Scotsman, including the train manager, are quick to ensure that the already immaculate and shining carriages are polished and cleaned, removing any last traces of dust before the passengers arrive. Just like a chauffeur with a limousine would do, awaiting the arrival of a VIP. And VIP treatment is one of this train's attributes. Check-in for the Royal Scotsman takes place in Edinburgh's finest hotel, the Balmoral. Here, amidst the traditional splendour of the hotel's exquisite five-star surroundings, the passengers are met and greeted by the train staff and allotted their cabins and boarding passes before being taken to meet the train. Their luggage is carefully labelled, and the hotel porters transfer it to a fleet of waiting taxicabs outside. The train steward makes a few last-minute checks for the train, ensuring that all passengers have checked in before the luggage is transported in convoy through the station concourse. As each bag is unloaded, it is again checked by a steward before being taken and placed in the correct cabin. On every tour of the Royal Scotsman, the departure is marked with a sense of grand occasion by a traditional kilted piper. Back at the Balmoral Hotel, the fleet of taxis has returned to collect the passengers. They arrive on the station concourse to a fanfare of bagpipes, 36 passengers who are about to embark on one of the world's great railway journeys. 36 adventurers, some from Britain and Germany, others from the United States of America, and even some from as far afield as Mexico, all board the train to share a breathtaking view of Scotland, a passing landscape which can only be revealed through the windows of a train, and a unique opportunity to experience over the next 5 days the very best of what this beautiful country has to offer. As the passengers, or guests as the train staff prefer to call them, are seated in the rear observation and lounge car, enjoying their first taste of the train's lavish hospitality, the final whistle is blown. Over the sound of the bagpipes, the train gradually glides away from the station platform. This journey will take us along some of Scotland's least used railway lines. From Edinburgh, we will head west, skirting past Glasgow and the northern bank of the Clyde, then turning north on the West Highland Line, travelling along the edge of Gairloch and Loch Lomond through some of Scotland's most dramatic and beautiful scenery. Passing Aracher and Crianlarach, we then head west towards Dalmally. The sleeping cars of the train were originally Pullman day cars and have all been extensively remodeled in the style of the Edwardian era, with the main emphasis on comfort and space. Each state cabin is beautifully fitted out in rich woods with inlaid marquetry, complemented with fine damasks and soft furnishings. Each cabin has lower beds and all of the comforts and amenities found in any luxury hotel, including dressing tables and full-length wardrobes. All have their own private bathroom with hand basin, toilet and shower, with endless supplies of hot water. The bathrooms are constantly supplied with acres of fluffy white towels and high quality complimentary toiletries. Wherever you go throughout the carriages, you are surrounded by an ambience of age-old splendor and lavish woodwork. Even the original fittings of the old braking system, which was replaced by a modern one, have been restored and renovated along with the rest of the train to pristine condition. Both of the dining cars have been extensively remodeled using rich mahogany panelling, each one offering a private, club-like atmosphere. At one end of this car is the well-stocked mahogany bookcase. In the lobby area, you can choose from a large range of Royal Scotsman collectible merchandising. The Royal Scotsman also boasts one of the best restaurants in Britain. The two dining cars have a variety of guest settings, from tables for six, four, or two diners, and guests are encouraged to try different tables throughout the journey, thus encouraging the guests to get to know one another. At the rear of the train is the observation car and lounge area, with ample seating for each and every guest. Here, passengers can meet over coffee and aperitifs from the bar, whilst enjoying the passing landscape. This is without doubt the train's most magnificent carriage. With its comfortable tartan sofas and upholstered armchairs, the walls are decorated with fine Scottish prints and inlaid mirrors. At the rear of this car is the open observation deck. And it was from here that we experienced the first part of our journey. Although it was raining, which is not unusual for Scotland, the passing scenery and landscape more than made up for the inclement weather, especially seen from such comfortable and opulent surroundings. Climbing and curving all the time, we passed by the edge of Gairloch, then Loch Long. At Aracher, we could see the glistening waters of Loch Lomond. As cameras snapped to record the breathtaking views, this was also a time to sit back and relax, breathing in the fresh Highland air, and watch the magnificent kaleidoscope of West Scotland unfurl. Climbing hard up Glenfallach, we head towards the junction at Crianlarach. Then turning off the main track, we head westward on the branch which leads to the port of Oban. With each mile, the scenery becomes more exciting. And as the sun breaks through the rain clouds, the backdrop becomes even more spectacular. We have now been travelling for 3.5 hours. In the distance is the small town of Dalmally. This small station, typical of the many stations on this line, will be the first stop on our journey and our chance to experience one of Scotland's traditional cottage industries. The moment the train stops, the staff are waiting to help the passengers onto the platform from the lobby. They are going to visit the Inveraw Smokehouse. Waiting at the station is the Royal Scotsman's handsome motor coach, its splendid imperial purple livery mirroring that of the train. Meanwhile, as the passengers wait on the platform, the train leaves and continues its journey empty to its next destination. A Accompanying the passengers is one of the Royal Scotsman's team of well-informed tour guides, who travels on the train and is on hand to point out places of interest en route and explain each excursion. The smokehouse at Inveraw is situated in grand mountain scenery, overlooking the lower reaches of the River Orne, a much-celebrated salmon river which runs into Loch Etive, and is just a short coach journey from the town of Dalmally. Meanwhile, the train is taken to the station at Tainault. Unlike some of the other luxury trains, the Royal Scotsman does not travel through the night, but stables at stations en route. Much to their amusement, they don the regulation clothing, and the passengers are shown around the smokehouse. Robert Campbell Preston, the present owner, began fish farming in 1981, and this smokehouse has since grown into a flourishing family business, producing a high-quality range of smoked Scottish fish and game. The first part is the cleaning and preparation, and Mr. Campbell Preston explains the process.
Whatever, if you're fisherman, table salt, it's not so good. We prefer rock salt. Lay it like this, and normally what happens is...
Outside are the actual smokehouses, and again the passengers are shown the traditional Scottish process of the fish being cured and smoked. Aware of Scotland's unreliable weather, the Royal Scotsman also provides the passengers with their own tartan umbrellas.
Drying the fish in the smoke. You're extending the salting, so you're drying it and flavouring it and coating the smoke to preserve it. But you're not, this is why I'm a hopeless salesman, you're not cooking it. Okay, you're just drying, rather like farmer ham, same principle, rather like a raw ham.
As the sun breaks through once again, the passengers are taken into the owner's home, where they're given the opportunity to sample some of the many Inveraw delicacies over a glass or two of fine wine. These include smoked salmon, trout and caviar, along with smoked venison, Argyle ham and duck. By now, the 30 or so passengers have started to get to know one another, and the friendships have started to form. As the Royal Scotsman sits at the platform at Tainault, its engine still cooling from the afternoon run, the motor coach arrives back from the smokehouse and is immediately greeted by the train manager, who escorts the passengers back to the train. As with every excursion, the passengers or guests are greeted by the ever-attentive crew with a choice of either champagne or a fruit punch, or occasionally, depending on the clemency of the weather, the traditional Scottish welcome of a hot toddy. On this train, the staff take great pride in ensuring that every guest is made to feel totally relaxed and at ease.
Cheers.
I prefer that. Yes. Okay, thank you very much.
Both on and off this train, the pace is leisurely and unhurried.
They are our guests, obviously. We like to try and run the train like we're hosting a dinner party, and they're our very best friends. And we have it for 5 days, and we're doing the best we possibly can for them. How we'd like to entertain your best friends for 5 days. We've taken every decision for them, so once they come on board, they can totally relax. We arrive at a station, and the coach is there to take them to another stately home, castle, smokehouse, distillery, where they're met by the Lord and Lady or the head distiller. And when they come back, we have the drinks on platform for them. They sit down at the dinner table, another wonderful meal arrives. Very different to the last one.
I think the first night is a bit anxious for everybody because they're on the train. They come onto the train, I don't think they don't know what to expect. And they come on the train then to see everyone is just so friendly and everything is so relaxed. The first night at dinner can be a bit tense for everybody because the table, sometimes they have to sit people they don't know. But after that, they all get to know one another and it's great.
Heard from you in 25 years. It was really good.
I would say that's fine. Wake up call at 8:30.
8:30, sir.
No. If you like to have breakfast, then you need it at 7 o'clock.
Dinner on board the Royal Scotsman for the first night is informal and the mood is relaxed. The combination of fresh Scottish produce and carefully selected wine make for a restaurant worthy of Michelin stars. Following dinner, the country house party ambience is enhanced by entertainment in the observation car with a distinctly Scottish flavour. As the entertainment draws to a close, the train and its guests settle down for the night. It is now almost midnight, and the sun is only just beginning to set. It was easy to appreciate why this is considered to be one of the most luxurious, and indeed, one of the most prestigious trains in the world. Day 2, and by 6 a.m. the train was rolling eastward, retracing the previous day's route, following the narrow shelf between the slopes of Ben Cruachan and the River Orr. On board, those guests who have risen early to see the morning sun come up are being served breakfast in the dining car. Further down the line, awaiting the arrival of the train, is the Royal Scotsman's motor coach. Just as the staff on the train are constantly busy polishing and cleaning, so too is Robert Fraser, the coach driver. Washing the coach is a daily affair. Our next stop is the ancient capital of Scotland, Perth. Known as the Fair City, Perth was the centre of royal administration in medieval Scotland, and the train's passengers are about to experience one of Perth's most important historic sites. As always, the coach is ready and awaiting the passengers' arrival. We have travelled east back to Crianlarich and once again joined the main line south. Skirting past the mouth of the Clyde and Glasgow, we've turned north, passing through Larbert and then Stirling, home of the magnificent castle which dominates the surrounding countryside. With the passengers now on board, along with the train's expert guide, the coach heads off for the centre of the city. As well as once being the political capital of Scotland, records dating back as early as the 9th century indicate that Perth was also the religious centre. The passengers are being taken to see the Kirk, or Church of St. John. Rebuilt in the 15th century on the same site as the earlier Kirk, the later structure was on a much larger and grander scale as a measure of importance in the life of Perth's community. Renovated and rededicated in 1926, the present Kirk is not just a city monument, but a working church for the community of Perth. The nave of the Kirk is a vast rectangular structure flanked by an aisle on both sides. Above the blank walls, which are supported by the two arcades, there is a handsome wooden ceiling of fumed oak. This roof is adorned by plaques illustrating the life of Jesus and other subjects, whilst above the aisles, the ceilings are constructed with finely detailed flat oak panels. The crossing of the Kirk contains the communion table and the pulpit. Four massive piers, one in each corner, support the heavy arches from the walls of the tower rise. On the west side of the northern transept is the memorial chapel, which one Sir Robert Lorimer built to commemorate the dead of the First World War. The shrine itself is within an arch recess, which has a statue of St. John the Baptist on its southern pier. The chief source of light is from a stained glass window depicting St. Michael. The west front incorporates both medieval and modern work, with the imposing central stained glass window set back in a recessed section. Above the choir section is one of the few surviving medieval open timber roofs. Following the renovations, it has once again been made possible to appreciate the magnificence of the Kirk as it once was, as a symbol of a living and enduring faith, and one which also now responds to the active modern parish of Perth. Back on board the coach, the passengers are given a drive-round tour of the city before being taken back to the comforts of the Royal Scotsman. The crew are once again on hand to greet the passengers on their arrival before they settle down to enjoy the culinary delights of the kitchen as lunch is about to be served. The whistle blows and the train slowly glides out of Perth station. From Perth, we are heading north through Dunkeld station, which is set, confusingly, not in Dunkeld, but in the village of Burnham. Burnham Hill lies to the south of this village and was once cloaked in forest. This forest was immortalised in Shakespeare's Macbeth. Macbeth shall never vanquished be until great Burnham Wood to high Dunsinane Hill shall come against him. The soldiers fighting Macbeth cut branches from the trees in the forest for camouflage, so giving the impression that the wood was moving. After Blair Athol Station, we catch a glimpse of Blair Castle. Near Dal na Cadach, General Wade's military road built in the 1720s skims overhead. Wade built some 260 miles of paved roads through landscapes where previously there had been nothing but rough tracks. Whilst the passengers relaxed after lunch in the observation car, the train continued its journey north. Time passes slowly and sedately on the Royal Scotsman. The locomotive and nine splendid carriages rarely exceed 40 miles per hour, allowing time for Scotland's superlative sights to unfold at a graceful pace. This was truly Bonnie Scotland. We pass through Dalwhinnie and then on to Aviemore, taken from the Gaelic Agidmore, meaning big gap. Up until the 1850s, when the railways first arrived, there was only a simple coaching inn here. But in the 1960s, the town became a mecca for sportsmen, skiers, and mountaineers. Seven miles from Aviemore, we come to Carbridge, a pleasant, quiet village, and a base for many of the holiday walkers and backpackers who frequent this part of Scotland, exploring the Cairngorm mountain range. It was here, in the early afternoon on day two of our journey, that the Royal Scotsman made its next stop. The passengers are being met once again by the motor coach to take them to see one of Scotland's many grand castles. Ballindalloch Castle, one of the most beautiful and romantic castles in Scotland, and one of the very few privately owned castles to be lived in continuously by its original family. The long line of Macpherson Grants have lived here since 1546. It is set in the magnificent surroundings of the Spey Valley and exemplifies the transition from the stark tower house necessary for survival in the 16th century to the elegant and comfortable country house so beloved by the Victorians in the Highlands during the 19th century. The family crest of the Macpherson Grants still sits proudly, cast in stone, over the front door. Ballindalloch also boasts a magnificent garden set amidst acres of landscape fields that stretch for miles. It is also the home of the famous Aberdeen Angus herd of cattle, founded by George Macpherson Grant in 1860, and is now the oldest herd in continuous existence. First and foremost, Ballindalloch is a much-loved family home with a family tree spanning over 450 years of Scottish history and tradition. This dining room is the largest room in the house and was the original great hall of this 16th century castle. The room is full of family portraits, including the paintings of George III and Queen Charlotte. Sir Ewan and Lady Macpherson Grant's daughter Claire is now the present lady of the house, and along with her husband, Mr. Oliver Russell, they share the task of showing guests around the house and grounds. As we continue the tour of Ballindalloch, the train moves off. It has once again come off the main line and has now been taken along a private section of track owned and operated by the independent Strathspey Steam Railway. Passengers are not allowed to travel on the train along this section, which is maintained and run by volunteers and enthusiasts from the local railway museum. The home of the museum and railway is situated at Boat of Garten, named after the ferry boat which crossed the River Spey. It developed as a village with the arrival of the railways and was once the junction point of the Highland and Great North of Scotland lines. The old station has been restored to its original condition, and the museum is housed in the old waiting room. The railway runs a daily service with a steam locomotive from Boat of Garten to Aviemore, Our train is being shunted into the station by a restored diesel locomotive, also owned by the private company. It is here that we shall stable for the night. As the Royal Scotsman pulled into the station, it looked almost incongruous, sitting amongst the array of old locomotives and carriages, all from a bygone age. An age that had accelerated the growth of this remote rural area, where over a century ago, towns had grown from small villages with cottages built around coaching inns into modern thriving communities, all connected by miles of parallel steel rails. It is now early evening, and the passengers are arriving back at the train. The Royal Scotsman and its guests have become something of a focal point. As the passengers congregate on the platform, sipping the, by now, customary glass of champagne, other visitors to the Railway Museum, expecting to see a platform full of rusting memorabilia, stand and gaze in astonishment at this new gleaming addition to the museum collection. Botev Garten lies just a short distance southeast of Inverness, high in the heather-clad hills above Loch Laggan, in an area famous for its ski slopes, salmon fishing, and ospreys. With the guests now showered and refreshed, dinner aboard the train tonight is a grand and formal black tie affair. Amidst tables adorned with fresh flowers, glistening silver cutlery, crested Royal Worcester china, sparkling crystal glassware, white linen napkins, neatly tied with burgundy satin bows, all under the romantic setting of candlelight, the guests enjoy what was described by Travel and Leisure magazine as being one of the very best restaurants in Britain, moving or stationary. And conversation was flowing, almost as much as the fine wines being served by the ever-attentive crew. As the conversation and conviviality continued into the night, there was something almost hedonistic about dining in such style and decadence. One almost felt wicked to be enjoying such luxurious surroundings and lavish cuisine, all against the distant backdrop of the Cairngorm Mountains. Day 3. We travel a short distance by motor coach to the Highland Wildlife Park. Set in 260 acres of beautiful Strathspey, all the animals here are indigenous to Scotland, with some now extinct in the wild, whilst others are endangered. Owned by the Royal Zoological Society of Scotland, the reserve offers a unique safari experience.
Very gentle retiring animals, these. Give you the effect of being quite slow and lumbering, but then by no means a fast animal like a horse, but they can actually sprint for short distances at about 40 miles an hour.
These Highland steers, once a wild species, are found in the main reserve. The red variety is a relatively new breed, whilst the older black variety is much rarer. These are mouflon, another rare antelope-type breed, which are ancient ancestors of sheep. Driving through the main reserve, we found many rare species all living together, including some which can still be found in Scotland's varied habitat. The rarest of these animals is the wild Chervalsky's horse. There are now only 1,200 of these horses left throughout the world, which are all protected by an international group of zoologists. Leaving the motor coach, the passengers are taken by foot into the reserve's woodland habitat, which is approached by a wooden boardwalk. 50 years ago, the whole reserve looked like this, but after World War II, the area was cleared to use the much-needed timber.
The breeding season will be in August, and he will be sticking like glue to the female when he gets into the rut in August.
The grouse and its peculiar call became the centre of amusement for many of our party.
My neighbours wouldn't tolerate it.
They wouldn't let you have it.
Neighbours.
The reserve also has several species of deer, including reindeer and the larger red deer, which is Scotland's largest land mammal, and also the roe deer. The European brown bear became extinct in Scotland in the Middle Ages, and this old female, housed in her own enclosure, is the reserve's only one of the species. After a two-hour tour, the passengers are back on the motor coach on their way to the Royal Scotsman. The train has been taken back along the private track to join up once again with the main line at Aviemore, which is where we rejoin the train to continue our journey. As the passengers enjoy lunch, the train heads north, retracing its journey to Carbridge. Then passing through Tomerton and Moy, we cross Culloden Moor. This was the site of the last ever battle fought on British soil, when on April the 16th, 1746, the Jacobite cause was finally subdued. A turning point in the history of the Scottish nation. From Culloden, we pass through the city of Inverness, the capital of the Highlands. And crossing the bridge at the mouth of the legendary Loch Ness, we then head west. We are now crossing what arguably is the most scenic route in the whole of Great Britain, passing through the towns of Dingwall and then Garve. The obvious route from Dingwall to Garve would have been through the spa town of Strathpeffer. But when this line was built, the local landowner refused to sell the necessary land to the railway, so the line climbed steeply to cross Raven Rock Summit, behind and out of sight of the town. Motor coach now heads off in front of the train to await its arrival further down the track at the town of Strathcarran. Heading due west, the line passes Loch Lucherd and the Torridon Mountains, which are so old that they contain no fossils. Geologists believe that they were formed before any form of life began. Next point is Achnasheen, which means field of rain, and just as the day we passed it, often lives up to its name. Last century, Queen Victoria arrived at Achnasheen by road, and the Presbyterian landlord of the coaching inn refused the Queen fresh horses and even refused to post her mail. Reaching the Luib summit and the Achnashellach forest, we then descend to Strathcarran. And it was here, at this remote station, we met up with the Royal Scotsman motor coach for the next part of our tour. Meanwhile, the train continues empty on its way to the west coast and the Kyle of Loch Alsh. The end of this line and a transit point on the route to the Isle of Skye. The imperial purple livery of the Royal Scotsman glistens in the afternoon sun as it snakes its way through the spectacular and dramatic landscape, the mountains on one side and Loch Carron on the other. The Kyle of Loch Alsh is situated on the westernmost tip of the Scottish Highlands mainland before reaching the Inner and Outer Hebrides. It was here on the station platform in the harbour, surrounded by fishing boats of every shape and size, that the Royal Scotsman stables for the third night of the journey. Awaiting the return of the guests, the chef is preparing the evening dinner.
Pop the salmon on. That's just balsamic vinegar. Yeah, we choose the menus. Hopefully going on local themes. Obviously we're in Kyle today, so to dinner tonight we'll have lobsters and langoustines. So try to theme the food round where we stop. Obviously always the best of Scottish produce, freshest of Scottish produce.
As the train sits at the Kyle of Loch Alsh, the passengers are visiting Atterdale House, situated on the south shore of Loch Carron, a sea loch which gives the magnificent garden surrounding the house the warm air of the Gulf Stream, although the latitude is the same as the Hudson Bay in Canada. The gardens were built and planted by the Schroeder family between 1890 and 1939. Baron Schroeder planted rhododendrons and imported trees, including Wellingtonias, sugars and West Coast redwoods. He laid out and landscaped an elaborate system of paths and steps around the gardens, which his son, Captain Schroeder, later extended over a further 20 acres. These included a water garden, a herb and vegetable garden, and a magnificent sunken garden. Many of the plants were imported from the rainforests of South America. Others originated in China and America. Visiting Atterdale was a remarkable opportunity to witness the tranquility of the Highlands and enjoy an astounding collection of plant life displaying Scottish garden design at its very best.
Yeah, it's certainly, we feel, is the best possible way of seeing the best of Scotland. We've put all the thought into it. Just come on board and sit back and relax. Have total confidence that everything's going to arrive and be delivered. You have a variety of visits. It's just a wonderful, exclusive way. Let us take all the hassle out of your holiday. Our crew take a great pleasure in what they're doing, and they're well selected, and the people we're very proud of, and they're great ambassadors for the train, whether they be at work or out of work. But what they're doing is very anticipative, and a lot of thought goes into what they're doing.
After another fine dinner and the sun sinking over the Isle of Skye, the guests are entertained by a performance on the Scottish harp, the clarsach.
Let us
early morning on day four of the tour, and we are visiting what is described as the most photographed castle in Britain, Eileen Donnan Castle. This most romantic of ancient Scottish castles stands alone on a rocky promontory at the confluence of the three sea lochs of Alsh, Long and Duich, against a backdrop of sheer mountains. The forbidding crenellated tower rises from the water's edge, joined to the shore by a narrow stone bridge. Built around 1220 by Alexander II to protect the area from the Vikings, the castle was later occupied by troops dispatched by the King of Spain to help the old pretender, James Stuart. However, when King George heard of their whereabouts, he sent his frigates to destroy the castle. Thereafter, it lay in ruins until the early 1920s, when it was restored. While we visited Eileen Donnan, the train staff were busy in their own restoration work.
Every time we stop at a station, everyone gets a turn doing the windows and the brass, just making the outside look as good as what the inside looks like. So keep everything shipshape.
There's always room for improvement, but we always like to keep everything clean as possible.
Well, obviously it is the most luxurious train, and 4 days you're seeing the most beautiful scenery of Scotland. You get a very friendly and very attentive crew. I mean, and great food, great wine, be great.
Our next visit was to cross the bridge to the Isle of Skye, the Misty Isle. Along with a glass of champagne, the guests, now arriving back from Skye, were welcomed by another traditional Scottish sight as they were piped back on board. Most couldn't pass up on the opportunity to catch the moment on film. By the time the Royal Scotsman slipped out of Kyle Station and we got underway once again, it was early afternoon and time to sit back and enjoy a leisurely lunch. As we retraced part of the previous day's route, winding our way eastward alongside Loch Carron, enjoying the fine wines and hospitality of the train, we were given a chance to see the spectacular views we'd missed on the westbound leg of our journey. Across the loch in a small bay, we could see the small whitewashed cottages of the village of Plockton. Continuing eastwards, towards the village of Gorston, we passed Loch Achnod and Loch Achulin, and we once again crossed over the River Grudi, which leads into Loch Luachd. We are travelling to Dingwall, about 20 miles northwest of Inverness. Close to Dingwall lies Eileen Dhu, the legendary Black Isle, and the home of the famous Glenore Distillery, our next port of call. Licensed in 1838, Glenore is an area with an ancient tradition of distilling, and is the last remaining survivor of no fewer than 9 such distilleries, which operated from Muiravord in Victorian days. Slow and patient maturing in oak casks enables Glenord 12-year-old single Highland malt to take its colour and to breathe and mellow until it reaches ultimate perfection. For the discerning whiskey drinker, including many of our fellow passengers, it was hard to resist sampling a tipple or two. Of course, having sampled the taste, it would have been a wasted opportunity not to have taken a bottle home.
Yes, it's wonderful.
So maybe I copy yours.
I'll bring it along to Mexico.
You're taking a bottle to Mexico.
Yeah. This is much more. Look, isn't this wonderful? My whiskey.
Very chic.
Yes.
Very chic. You were right to buy it. Very good idea.
Sam, with your malt.
Back on the train, we continued our sampling of a wee dram or two from other Scottish distilleries with the assistance of a local whiskey expert.
We started you off with something fairly light. Glenord is a fairly light whiskey. This is also fairly light, but this one has, I think you'll find, almost a slightly aromatic flavor to it. But it's, as I say, it's light in character, not quite a breakfast whiskey, but pre-lunch for this one, shall we say. And it produces a rather light spirit, which is rather oily in flavor. That's a maize oil.
During our guided tour of whiskey bottles, the train moves off, taking us round the edge of the Beauly Firth and crossing the northern end of the Caledonian Canal into Inverness. Travelling due east, we pass through the town of Nairn and then through Forres. To the south of this town lie the Clunie Hills. Continuing east, we pass through Elgin. We are now on the final leg of our journey. After stabling overnight, we will follow a route which will take us towards Aberdeen. Then following the east coast line, we will head down to Dundee and back into Edinburgh. It is now our final night on board the Royal Scotsman. About 50 miles east of Elgin, we arrive at the town of Keith. And it is here that we enjoy our last formal dinner and stable overnight before setting off early the next day. Day 5, the final day of our tour. We are woken by the reverberating sound of the train as it rumbles its way across the Tay Bridge at Dundee. This is the second bridge to span the river, the first having collapsed during a storm in 1879, claiming the lives of 100 passengers in a train crossing the bridge at the time. Hopefully, this current bridge is more robust. However, Taybridge seemed small in comparison to the next wondrous piece of railway architecture which we were about to encounter as we crossed the Firth of Forth, the magnificent Forth Bridge. Nearly at our journey's end, having spent the past 5 days aboard the Royal Scotsman, it was a time for reflection. A time to remember and appreciate all that we had been privileged to witness. Some of the most beautiful scenery in Europe, mountain ranges and remote islands, grand castles and country homes, picturesque fishing villages, nature reserves and beautiful gardens. We had witnessed firsthand age-old Scottish crafts of distilling and smoking, and had sampled the very best food and delicacies that this country rich in tradition has to offer. And all experienced whilst travelling one of the most luxurious and hospitable means of travel available in this modern age of transport. This unique and truly superb train, the Royal Scotsman. Gliding into Edinburgh Waverley Station, enjoying our final moments on board, we recalled our first day, when we were looking forward to our journey with anticipation. What would we see? What was the food going to be like? Was this train comfortable? Would it live up to our expectations? Now saying their goodbyes to each other on the station platform, having spent 4 nights and 5 wondrous days together on a journey of a lifetime, nobody could say they were disappointed, for the Royal Scotsman is truly an aristocrat of trains.